南无萨埵陀输且多耶阿赖合地三藐三菩提耶。
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 南无大方广佛华严经华严海会佛菩萨。
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 Homage to the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra of Great Expansive Teachings.
Homage to the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra of Great Expansive Teachings.
And the Ocean-Wide Flower Garland Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas.
The Ocean-Wide Flower Garland Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattva. 无上甚深微妙法，百千万劫难遭遇。我今见闻得受持，愿解如来真实义。
The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual meaning.
上人、各位法师还有各位佛友，大家阿弥陀佛。今天是2014年2月15日，星期六的晚上。现在我们是在加州伯克莱圣寺、来一起研究大方广佛华严经的十地品，现在已经到第五地南圣地。
Venerable Master, Dharma Masters, all Dharma friends, tonight we are in Berkeley Buddhist Monastery in California, United States of America. Today is February 15th, a Saturday evening. And we're investigating the Avatamsaka Sutra, the 10 grounds chapter, and we're on the fifth ground, the ground of difficult conquest.
首先呢，我们大家一起来把中英文、先读一遍。现在是在第50页，中文50页，那底下最底下的一段，我们把这一段经文读了，然后接着读英文。
So we will first read the Chinese and English of the sutra text, and then begin the lecture. So where we're going to start reading is on the bottom of page 50.
请合掌第五十页。
So、the
佛子，
佛子，
是名略说，
是名略说，
菩萨摩诃萨，
菩萨摩诃萨，
第五南圣地。
第五南圣地，
菩萨住此地，
菩萨住此地，
多作多帅陀天王，
多作多所台天王，
于诸众生，
于诸众生，
所作自在，
所作自在，
摧伏一切外道邪见，
摧伏一切外道邪见，
能令众生住实地中。
能令众生住实地中，
布施，
布施，
爱语，
爱语，
力行，
力行，
同事，
同事，
如是一切，
如是一切，
诸所作业，
诸所作业，
皆不离念佛，
皆不离念佛，
不离念法，
不离念法，
不离念僧，
不离念僧，
乃至不离念具足一切种。
乃至不离念具足一切种，
一切自治，
一切自治。So we begin on page 51, the English, the very second to last paragraph. disciples of the Buddha. Disciples of the Buddha. This is Buddha. We can read it together. Disciples of the Buddha. This is called a general discussion of the Bodhisattvas, Mahasattvas, fifth ground of difficult conquest. The Bodhisattva who dwells upon this ground usually becomes king of the Tushita heaven, and towards all living beings acts with comfort and ease. He subdues all deviant views of externalists and can bring all living beings to dwell within absolute truth. In giving kind words, beneficial actions, and similar work, all of the karmic actions he performs are not separate from mindfulness of the Buddha, not separate from mindfulness of the Dharma, not separate from mindfulness of the Sangha, up to and including not being separate from mindfulness of endowment with the wisdom of the knowledge of all modes.
好，那我们现在就一起来研究经文。虽然在上个星期我们把这段经文的前面部分有讲解过了，不过今天做一个很简单的这种复习，那大家会印象更深刻。这里就讲到佛子是名略说菩萨摩诃萨，第五难胜地这是金刚藏菩萨，他是这个十地品的一个会主，那带佛来宣说十地品，所以金刚藏菩萨就称了一个佛子，就是说所有与会的这些菩萨们，是名略说菩萨摩诃萨，是呢很简略的，不是很详细的，大概的说了一下这个菩萨摩诃萨第五难胜地，就是在第五地。这个难胜地呢菩萨这个所修行的种种法门，那这个难呢，中文可以讲就是很困难很不容易的。这个胜呢，也可以做很多不同的解释，比如说我们胜利了，就是我们做什么事情我们呢最后成功了，那就是代表在很困难的情况之下，那你把一个事情做成功了，那意思这个事情不是很容易就可以完成的。或是呢，这个在很困难当中你呢完成了一个事情，那而且呢完成了一个很殊胜的任务，所以呢到一个菩萨的果位叫难胜地。
So although we already went over this passage last week, I thought it would be good to start from the beginning and give people a brief review so that your understanding of this passage will be even deeper. So this section starts with disciples of the Buddha. This is said by Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva, who is the, you could say, Dharma host of the Ten Grounds chapter. He speaks on the Ten Grounds. And so here, he gives a general discussion, which means he's just giving an overview. It's not a detailed explanation of this particular ground. He's giving an overview. And so here, he talks about the Bodhisattva, Mahasattva, Mahasattva meaning a great Bodhisattva, the fifth ground of difficult conquest. So for difficult, it means it's something very difficult to do, or it's not easy to accomplish. And for conquest, the Chinese character is sun, and it can be interpreted in many ways. One idea of it is victory, as in you win, you do something and you're victorious. Or you're able to achieve something or accomplish something that is very difficult to do. You carry out a very difficult task. So you can say that's the meaning for sun, here translated as conquest.
菩萨住此地，这个菩萨呢，他住在第五地，难胜地的时候呢，多坐多率头天王。那么大部分的菩萨呢，他会到这个多率头天去做天王。这个多率头呢是梵文，如果我们翻译成中文叫知足所以是一个知足天，表示这个天的天人呢，他们知足常乐，那么也享受到很大的天福，因为多率头天在我们欲界天的第四天，那个在三界里头呢如果因为我们持五戒行十善，都可以到这个天上享天福。那么一般人呢，享天福都在欲界天，因为呢到色界天他们就修禅定了，无色界天呢已经没有这个身体的形体。那么欲界天的第一天叫四王天，在须弥山的半山腰。 那这里的天人呢，他寿命是五十岁，不是，他的寿命是五百年，这个五百年。那么可是狮王天呢，他天人呢，一天一夜，因为很快乐，所以就是我们的人间五十年。那么第二天呢，叫做刀立天，又叫做三十三天，因为刀立天在须弥山的顶上，那么它中间呢就叫刀立天，那旁边呢东西南北各有八天，那么所以四八三十二加起来呢总共有三十三天，所以刀立天呢它又称为三十三天，它是在这个须弥山的最顶端，那须弥山呢很高，它有八万四千由旬，所以呢这狮王天或是刀立天呢都叫做地居天。为什么叫地居天呢？他们居住在这个土地上，跟我们人类一样，生活在地球上，有一个土地可以做依止的。那么所以欲界天的第一天是王天，还有第二天刀立天的天人，他们也是有一个土地，那宫殿呢就在这个土地上，那么所以呢他们也生活在有土地的地方，叫做地居天。
So here, this bodhisattva lives on the fifth ground, or has accomplished the fifth ground. And so here it says that this bodhisattva is usually a king of the Tushita heaven. Now, the word Tushita is a Sanskrit word, but when it's translated over, it means contentment. So we have the saying, when you're contented or satisfied, you're always happy. So here in this heaven, they're always happy and content. And it's the fourth heaven in the desire realm. And in this realm, it's within the three realms, the form realm, the desire realm, the form realm, and the formless realm. So this is the fourth heaven in the desire realm. And you get here from holding the five precepts and practicing the 10 good deeds. And you create blessings for the heavens. Now, to be able to get to the form realm and the formless realms, those require one to also cultivate dhyana. So to get to the form realms, you need to have dhyana concentration or meditative skill. And for the formless realms, it's as well, you need to have meditative ability. So in the form realm, if you talk about the heavens, there's the heavens, which where the four king heaven, we call them the four heavenly kings or the four ruling kings in the heavens, and they live at the midway. There's in Buddhism, there's the Mount Sumeru, which is like a cosmological mountain, and they live halfway up this mountain, and their lifespan is 500 years. Now, their 500 years actually is quite long compared to human years, because one day and one night in the heavens of the four heavenly kings is 50 years in the human realm. Above them, at the top of Mount Sumeru, is the Triamshimsha heaven. It's also translated as the heaven of the 33. This is because there's eight heavens to the north, eight heavens to the south, eight heavens to the east, eight heavens to the west, and then one heaven in the middle. So 4 times 8 plus 1 is 33. And so that makes the 33 heavens that are the top of Mount Sumeru. And in Mount Sumeru is said to be 84,000 yojanas in height. And these two heavens, the four heavenly kings, and the heaven of the 33, are considered heavens that still rely on, you could say, physicality, physical location. So their heavens or their palaces are built on physical land. They still live in this, in our world.
那么第三天呢，叫做夜摩天。这个夜摩天呢，是它空虚天了，因为它没有土地，就在虚空中。那么夜摩天的天人呢，他的福报更大，寿命更长，所以呢，他的寿命呢是两千年。刚刚讲的刀立天是一千年的寿命，可是刀立天的天人他一天一夜就是我们人间的一百年了，因为更快乐，所以同样的情形到夜摩天呢，他要加倍，变成说如果他一天一夜的话，那么我们人间呢就要变成是两百年。那这个以前呢这个佛呢 都会到这个夜摩天宫啊去讲法的，比如说去讲这个啊这个华严经，也在夜摩天宫讲过。那么第四天呢，叫做多帅陀天，就是现在啊第五地南圣地这个菩萨，他在多帅陀天来做这个天王，来统领这些天人。那事实上，这个多帅陀天呢，他分内院跟外院。外院就是一般的天界，就是一般有福报的人，他升到第四天多帅陀天的外院，就是一般的天界。那这里的天人呢，就是像刚刚讲，他寿命了两千年，然后呢，一日一夜就是人间的两百年，那福报是很大的。可是呢，在这一天也有一个叫做涅院，这个涅院呢，我相信大家都很熟悉，叫多帅涅院，是弥勒菩萨所住的地方。也就是说，弥勒菩萨呢，现在就在这个第四天多帅陀天的这个涅院，那他在里面呢，啊，等待着到人的寿命从现在一直减，减到十岁了，每一百年减十，减一岁，减到十岁，等到人的寿命从十岁又经过一百年，才增加一岁，一直增加，增加到八万四千岁，那八万四千岁又经过。每一百年啊，再减一岁，减到八万岁的时候，你看呢？就现在从我们的寿命减到十岁，然后从十岁又增加到八万四千岁，再从八万四千岁又减到八万岁。这个时候，弥勒菩萨要降生到人间来成佛，所以弥勒菩萨这段时间呢，他就在啊夜摩这个多帅陀天的内院里头呢，在那边啊做一个补处菩萨，补处就是。啊，补佛的这个位置，因为释迦牟尼佛入涅槃了，那么在这中间呢，佛在三千年前入涅槃以后，那我们娑婆世界到弥勒出世以来，这中间不会有佛的，除非十方的佛到我们娑婆世界来度化众生，但是我们不一定会知道，也不一定有这个因缘，所以真正要执佛出世，是要等到弥勒菩萨再降生到人间，但是弥勒菩萨到人间来之前，他就在多帅涅院。那在那边做什么呢？他当然也在讲经说法，很多人呢也在这个多帅涅院啊，就是在听弥勒菩萨在讲法教化众生。所以在古来的这个中国祖师，有很多人啊，就是他往生以后呢，也在这个多帅涅院啊，跟弥勒菩萨来学习。
So the next heaven, which is the third heaven, is the Suyama heaven. Now, the Suyama heaven is actually located in, you could say, in this space. It's not actually on the physical ground. It's actually located in midair. And here, the gods have even longer lifespans. They have a lifespan of 2,000 years. In the heaven of 33, they had a lifespan of 1,000 years. And as was mentioned before, the one day and one night in the heavens, it corresponds to a much longer span of years in the human realm, because they are so happy, the time passes so quickly. So one day and one night in the heaven of the 33 is 100 years. Now, in the Suyama heaven, which is the third heaven, their lifespan is 2,000 years, and for one day and one night is 200 years in the human realm. So there, you can see they're very, very happy, and it's very, very blissful. And they have a lot of heavenly blessings. In fact, the Buddha himself went to the heavens to teach the Dharma. And the Avatamsaka Sutra, part of it, was spoken in the Suyama heaven. Now, the fourth heaven up is the Tushita heaven, which is the heaven we're mentioning here. Here, this Bodhisattva on the fifth ground of difficult conquest is a leader among, is the king in the Tushita heaven. So he leads a lot of the gods in the Tushita heavens. Now, I believe that many here are familiar with the Tushita heaven, that there's two parts to the Tushita heaven. There's the outer court and the inner court. The outer court is where I was just mentioning the 2,000 years of the devas, or the gods. They live for 2,000 years and live a very blissful life in the outer court. However, in the inner court, of the Tushita heaven, there is something that I believe everybody knows, is that Maitreya Bodhisattva is living there currently. He currently resides in the inner court of the Tushita heaven and is waiting for his time to come into this human world to become a Buddha. Now, when will this happen? Well, it requires the humans, our lifespans will basically decrease 1 year every 100 years. So the human lifespan will decrease 1 year every 100 years. And so until the human lifespan decreases to 10 years of age, then the human lifespan begins increasing again. So every 100 years, it increases 1 year. And so it gets to 84,000 years. So after living for 84,000 years as an average lifespan, then again it starts going down. And when the lifespan of humans becomes 80,000 years, that's when Maitreya Bodhisattva will appear in this world and become a Buddha. So in between this period of time from Shakyamuni Buddha to Maitreya Bodhisattva coming to become a Buddha, there will be no Buddha that will appear in this world other than, you could say, Buddhas maybe transform into this world or teach in transformations, but there's not. It's not that everybody meets them. And they're not considered the Buddha of this time period. So what is Maitreya Bodhisattva doing in the inner court of the Tushita heaven? Well, he's there teaching the Dharma, lecturing on the sutras. He's teaching many people, and many people study with him. If you read the ancient masters in China, quite a few of them have go to the inner court to learn with Maitreya Bodhisattva, the Dharma.
那弥勒菩萨所住的这个兜率内院是一个净土，它是清净的国度，就像西方极乐世界一样，没有染污的。那所以古来很多法师都在这里修行，即使在《法华经》第28品也讲到说，如果依照法华经修行的人，命中以后也可以升到这个兜率陀天的内院去见到这个弥勒菩萨，听弥勒菩萨来讲法。 那么在1952或是1953年左右，那么我们都知道虚云老和尚那个时候他有一个事件发生了，在历史上称为叫云门事件，就是在这个云门呢，那边老和尚呢，因为被诬陷了，说呢一些有些他藏匿的一些人，所以呢那个时候老和尚呢被 一些人给毒打了，就是用棍子或是铁棍，或是用拳头脚踢就这样打他，很多人呢来打，那把老和尚的那个身上的骨头都打断了，甚至打昏死了。但是这些人呢也没有放过，那有一次呢，又老和尚又被打了，打到都很危险了。这时候虚云老和尚呢，他因为修行有功夫，他可以入定了，所以他就盘起腿来。 他当时就把腿盘起来，然后就入定了。这一入定呢，他呢就升到兜率陀天弥勒菩萨的内院。那在那里呢，他就看到很多人，看到他的看到这个弥勒菩萨，看到阿难尊者。你看阿难尊者以前是佛的侍者可是也在这个兜率陀天的弥勒内院里头。那虚云老和尚说呢，阿难尊者在那边做维奴，然后呢。 还有这个很多虚云老和尚所认识的中国的这些法师也在这个在听弥勒菩萨讲经说法。那么虚云老和尚在那边听了经以后呢，他都记得了。等到那个听经完了，这个弥勒菩萨看到他，就用手指着他说：“哦，你回去要这个虚云老和尚回去。”他说：“你这个寺院呢？” 还没有了，所以你应该继续回去。但是虚云老和尚说他不愿意再回到人间，他说人间呢太苦了，所以呢他不愿意回来。但是弥勒菩萨很坚持说你呢一定要回去。最后呢，虚云老和尚就回来了。回来以后，他因为入定出定以后呢，他知道他去这个兜率内院，所以呢他就把他的侍者找来说：“你赶快呢拿这个纸跟笔来把我讲的这个。” 所有的事情都记下来。那弥勒菩萨那个虚云老和尚就把他在兜率内院所听弥勒菩萨所讲的法或是记诵，复述出来，要他的那个侍者把他记录下来。那可见呢，这个 所以呢，这个弥勒菩萨所住的内院呢，确实是一个很多大修行人啊所修行的地方。等于说，他们继续在这个净土里头来修行，那么也等着将来呢，再回到世界上来度化众生。
So, Maitreya Bodhisattva's inner court is a pure land. There is no defilements there. You can say it's in many ways like Amitabha's pure land. In the Lotus Sutra, in the chapter 28, there is a description on how basically if one cultivates, according to the Lotus Sutra, one can be reborn in the Tushita heaven, in the inner court, and see Maitreya Bodhisattva. I believe people know of Venerable Master Shi Ying or Venerable Master Empty Cloud. I believe sometime between 1952 and 1953, there was an incident that happened. It's called a Yuengmen incident. And this time, Venerable Master Shi Ying was heavily beaten by people who came to the monastery. And they used steel rods. They kicked him. They beat him with wooden rods. They maybe even punched him to the point that his bones were broken and he fainted. And this happened twice. The second time, because his cultivation was quite solid, he later sat up in full lotus and entered samadhi. And when he entered samadhi, he was actually went off to the inner court and Tushita heaven and saw Maitreya Bodhisattva. There he saw many people he recognized. He saw Maitreya Bodhisattva, he saw Ananda, Ananda, who is the Buddha's attendant, is also there now. He's in the Tushita heaven. He said Ananda there was being the waino. He was there being the chanter, singing the praises. And he also saw many Chinese Buddhist masters. They were all there as well, listening and studying the Dharma under Maitreya Bodhisattva. So after the sutra lecture, so Venerable Master Empty Cloud also listened to the sutra lecture. And after the lecture, Maitreya Bodhisattva saw Venerable Master Empty Cloud and told Venerable Master Empty Cloud he has to go back to this world. He said, your work, your jobs in this world are not done yet. Venerable Master Empty Cloud said, no, I don't want to go back. It's just too much suffering there. And however, Maitreya Bodhisattva was very, he insisted and said you had to go back. So Venerable Master Empty Cloud left, basically came back, and when he came out of samadhi, he told his attendant to quickly get a paper and pen and write down all the things that he saw and learned. So he wrote down what were the things that he learned in the Dharma from Maitreya Bodhisattva, and also who he saw, and the verses of praise and the Dharma that was spoken. So we can see that many great cultivators go to Maitreya Bodhisattva's Pure Land in the Tushita Inner Court.
或许我们听了会很羡慕，说如果我们往生了到多帅内院去跟弥勒菩萨来学习，去听他讲经说法，一样可以开悟，或是呢成就菩萨道。那这是没有错的啊，因为多帅内院本身就是一个净土，而且他确实也有福报。那目前呢，我知道啊，有些佛教徒他们也发愿要升到多帅内院去。但是呢，这个院是不是很安全呢？是不是比发愿到西方极乐世界更好呢？不见得了，因为在天台的智者大师曾经讲了一个故事。这个故事是说呢，有三个菩萨，这个都在印度的啊。这些菩萨，有一个叫狮子觉菩萨，有一个叫天亲菩萨，有一个叫无轴菩萨。天亲跟无轴菩萨是很出名，他们做了很多论啊，就是这个来弘扬大乘佛法的。那这两个兄弟呢，他们对佛教很有贡献的。当时呢，这三个菩萨都发愿呢，说啊，将来呢，他们也要往生到多帅内院去。或是哪一个人呢？先到了多帅内院，那么一定要回来告诉另外两个人说那边的情形。那结果呢？这个 狮子觉菩萨呢就先往生了。往生以后呢，那这个天亲菩萨跟无着菩萨等了好久都没有看到这个狮子觉菩萨回来，那么他们就觉得很奇怪。以后呢，等到这个天亲菩萨往生了，那么他呢去了又回来，这个回来呢他就告诉无着菩萨啊，说他到了这个兜率涅槃了，然后啊怎么样怎么样。那无着菩萨就觉得很奇怪，说那为什么狮子觉菩萨他比你早去，他没有回来告诉我们，反而是你啊后来才去的人，你现在啊反而回来呢啊。这个天亲菩萨就说呢，狮子觉菩萨呢他到这个欲界的第四天啊，兜率陀天，因为到那边有这个外院跟内院，外院就是一般的天界，很快乐的，那边天人这个福报太大了，寿命四千岁，那这个施衣衣制施食食制，你要穿什么这个衣服呢就在身上，你要吃什么想一想，食物就在眼前啊，所以住的宫殿又漂亮，然后天上的天女呢更漂亮，一个比一个漂亮。所以呢狮子觉菩萨因为呢他定力还不足，等到他到这个第四天兜率头天的时候呢，那个外院他看到这种天界这么啊福报这么大，还有这种种的享福享受呢，所以他就迷了，他根本没有走到这个兜率内院去，就在兜率外院啊，就在那边享天福了。所以呢这个其实在佛教来讲就是堕落，因为天不尽了就会在堕落受果报。那这就是其实智者大师在、啊、提醒我们说，虽然弥勒菩萨的兜率涅槃是很好，但是我们除非很有把握，否则呢定力不足很容易呢就在兜率陀天的这个外院呢可能就迷了、啊、就不知道继续修行。所以就鼓励我们，如果我们发愿，一定要发愿往生西方极乐世界，因为你到西方极乐世界去的时候呢，在那边是啊，就是莲花化生。那莲花化生的花开就见佛了，见佛就啊会开始这个证无生，证无生法忍，就是表示等到我们到西方极乐世界花开见佛悟无生以后，就到一种不动地的菩萨了，到第八地菩萨。为什么？因为证得不退转了，就是说你的修行也不退转，你的证得的果位也不退转，你的每个念头也不退转了，那时候就是表示真的有定力。这个时候你有定力呢，你到娑婆世界，你到这个、啊、天界，或是像刚刚讲的多率陀天的外院去，你也不会被迷了，因为有定力，所以不会退转，不会从一个菩萨的果位、啊、退到一个凡夫了。那因此呢，这个智者大师在讲净度法门的时候特别提醒我们说，虽然兜率陀天的这种内院是很好，但是呢定力不足的人还是不要发愿、啊、到那边去，否则呢可能就会跟这个狮子觉菩萨、啊、这个后果是一样的。
Okay, so people might have a lot of admiration for the inner court of Maitreya Bodhisattva's teaching, where he teaches in the inner court of the Tushita heaven. It's for sure not a bad place. It's a pure land, and there's a lot of blessings there. And people really cultivate there. However, people think, well, maybe I should go there and maybe not go to the pure land, Amitabha Buddha's pure land in the West. However, there's another story that the great master Zizi, who is part of the Tiantai tradition, he told a story of these three bodhisattvas in India. Their names are Zizi Jue, and the other two are Asanga and Vasubandhu. Asanga and Vasubandhu are very famous in Mahayana Buddhism because they wrote a lot of treatises and works. And so these three bodhisattvas, Zizi Jue, Vasubandhu, and Asanga, they all cultivated together and made vows to go to the inner court of the Tushita heaven to see Maitreya Bodhisattva. And they made a deal with each other, saying whoever gets there first has to come back and tell the rest of us what it's like there. So after they die, they have to go and they get reborn there. And when they come back, they let us know what it's like. So Sizije was the one who passed away first. And so he went off to rebirth and there was no news. Later, Vasubandhu Bodhisattva also went off to rebirth. And it took him a while, but he finally came back and met a Sangha Bodhisattva and told the Sangha Bodhisattva what it was like. He said, "Wow, why did it take you so long?" Vasubandhu explained, "Well, he just just went around the Maitreya Bodhisattva, and since the heavens are so much longer than the human realm, he came right back, but basically it was much longer in the human realm." Then he said, "Well, how about our fellow cultivator, Sizije?" Now Vasubandhu said, "Well, Sizije Bodhisattva, he got lost because the outer court of the Tushita heavens are so blissful. It's so, you could say, amazing and full of blessings. You know, whatever, the lifespan is 4,000 years. The clothes, whatever one wants to wear, they just appear immediately to be worn. Whatever one wants to eat, it just appears before oneself. And then the goddesses are extremely beautiful. One's just even more beautiful than the next. And so Sizije Bodhisattva, his samadhi wasn't that strong. And so he got moved and got, lost in the outer court of the Tushita heaven, seeing this, the bliss and the happiness. It was just so, so attractive. So we know, though, however, in Buddhism, that by just getting caught up in heavenly blessings, that's actually a big step back in our cultivation. Because for heavenly blessings, one day they will be used up, and then one has to fall, or one will re-enter this samsaric cycle in another form. And so becoming lost in the heavenly blessings isn't a good thing. Rather, if our samadhi is not solid, it is much better to be reborn in the Western Pure Land of Amitabha Buddha, because there we will be reborn in a lotus flower. And when that lotus flower opens, we'll see the Buddha. And at that point, realize the patience of the non-production of dharmas. And that's the realization of an eighth ground bodhisattva who abides in the ground of unmoving. And when we're there, then we don't have any way of retreating. We won't retreat in terms of our position, the stage that we've cultivated, or our cultivation, or even the thoughts in our minds. We won't have any thought of retreating. And so then we can go to Maitreya Bodhisattva's inner court in the Tushita heaven, but we won't be moved by the outer court. And so Great Master Zizza here told the story to say, for those who might see that the inner court of Maitreya Bodhisattva is very wonderful, however, if we do not have sufficient samadhi, it's still safer, it's still better to be reborn in Amitabha Buddha's Pure Land.
所以这就是为什么第五地南圣地的这个菩萨，他要到多帅陀天来做天王，因为多帅陀天这个天界这么快乐，寿命这么长，福报这么大，可是这些天人，他们享受完这些福报以后， 还是会回到六道继续轮回，因此呢，菩萨呢，他发慈悲心，就到多帅陀天来做天王，来教化这些天人，让他们能够继续来修行，不要堕落。所以呢，这个经文就讲说，于诸众生，那么所作自在。那么这个第五地南圣地的菩萨呢，他在这个天界，天人之中呢，他是所行所作是最自在的，就是说他所行所作呢，都是没有束缚的，很解，就是都是可以得解脱的，没有烦恼的。那就是一个示现，菩萨在这个天界做一个示现，让天人有一个学习的榜样，然后同时也用种种这种天界的法令来教化他们。
So therefore, this bodhisattva on the fifth ground becomes a king in the Tushita heavens. Why does he do this? Because he sees that in the Tushita heavens, these gods have a huge amount of blessings. However, after they use up their blessings, they will still have to be reborn into other realms in the six paths. And because of that, he teaches them not to be lax, not to just enjoy their blessings, but still continue to cultivate. And so here it says that this Bodhisattva, the king of the Shita heaven and towards all living beings, acts with comfort and at ease. So this Bodhisattva here basically is extremely comfortable, extremely at ease, and he has no afflictions whatsoever. And he is, you could say, a role model, exemplar. He embodies the kind of peacefulness and the self-mastery of a cultivator that inspires the other gods to learn the Dharma.
这个菩萨因为他有政治正见，所以他可以摧服一切外道邪见。那在印度，释迦牟尼佛住世的时候有96种外道。这个外道呢，也有他们的这种经典，也有他们的修行的法门，甚至也有神通，也有定力。但是外道的这种，比如说他们的戒律叫邪戒，他的戒律呢是。 知见不正的，或是呢，他得到的定力是一种邪定，就有别于佛教得到的这种正定。还有呢，他这种即使正得了神通，也是一种这种知见不正的，就是一种邪的神通。因此，这个外道这邪知邪见呢，如果对一些迷惑无知的人没有学习佛法，他们就信以为真，那么就堕到这个外道里头。可是呢，菩萨呢，可以用他的 政治正见来摧服一切邪外道的邪知邪见。那这个外道呢，其实在古代是讲96种外道。以现在来讲呢，我们要怎么来定义这个外道？这个外道呢，其实叫做心外求法，就是说，如果我们要求得一个法，求得一个真理，或是求得一个果位。 这个果位是正的果位，像佛果一样。那如果呢，我们不像我们的这种自信里头去求来修行的话，而是从外面去找，这样的这种修行就叫做外道。因此呢，如果这种修行呢不能证得自己的这种清净的法身，或是呢明白我们的自性，就像楞严经讲的明心见性的话，那么这个修行的结果都叫做外道。
So here the Bodhisattva subdues all deviant views of externalists. The Bodhisattva, you could say, has right views and a correct understanding. And so based on his correct views, he can subdue, he can subdue and convince or persuade all the externalists. They can't talk over him. And in the Buddhist time, there's said to be 96 externalist groups. You can say another way of translating externalist may be non-Buddhist or non-Buddhist teachings, non-Buddhist groups that don't teach an ultimate path. And so they, all these different externalist groups, they have various holy texts. They have their own methods of cultivation, and they even can cultivate spiritual powers and a certain amount of concentration and samadhi as well. However, their rules and structures of practice, as well as their understandings and views, and also their concentrated practices, are all not proper. They're just slightly off. Even their spiritual powers that they get are also not the proper kind of proper type of spiritual power that's explained in Buddhism. And so, for the Bodhisattva, because he has proper views and proper understanding, he can subdue all these externalist groups. Now, here in modern times, how can we want to define an externalist in terms of an external path? Well, the saying would be to seek the Dharma outside our own minds. Basically, look for some kind of realization or look for some teaching that's not inherent in our own nature. We seek outside. We look for some external thing to somehow certify us or to say we got some realization. This is considered an externalist path. Rather, we see that in the Buddha's teachings, the ultimate is to be able to look within and see our true nature, and then we can really have an awakening.
这个佛教呢，如果修行依据佛讲的种种法门呢，那你用哪一个法门来修行，就一定会证得一种果位，就是会有结果的，就是一分耕耘一分收获，不会说你修行呢到最后一无所得。比如说呢，在十法界里头有叫做四圣法界，圣人的法界就是他们依据佛所教导的法门修行，证得这种圣人了，出离三界的果位了。如果你依这个四圣地法，就会证到声闻的果位，就是证大阿罗汉果。如果依照十二因缘法来修行，就可以证这个圆觉的果位，就是必知佛的果位。如果依据六波罗蜜来修行，就可以证得菩萨种种的果位。这个《华严经》讲得很清楚，菩萨呢从这个十信、十住、十恨、十回向、十地等觉妙觉每一个这个菩萨的位阶都有一个果位会证得的。那现在我们所看到就已经是第五地的菩萨，他证到第五地了，所以有一个标准。或是呢，我们修行唯一佛证，就是依照《法华经》所讲的这个。没有声闻，没有缘觉，没有菩萨这样的法门了，只有唯一佛证，就是修行直到成佛为止，那就会证得一个佛的果位，叫佛果。所以呢，这个根据佛所讲的教法来修行呢，那这样的修行绝对功不唐捐的，就是不会让我们最后一无所得或是说你修行呢什么都没有结果，或是堕落，绝对不会的，否则佛就打妄语。那因此如果你不明白佛法，依外道的这种法门来修行，那智者大师他有一个譬喻，他用这个花来做譬喻。比如说外道，这些外道修行呢，有些很用功他们也修苦恨，那甚至这修行的这种方式呢，比佛教的这种苦恨还苦。可是呢，因为他道理不究竟，是一些邪知邪见，所以虽然修了很多苦恨，但是最终呢，没有结果，不会正果。所以智者大师就说呢，譬如呢，那个有一些树，或是果树，这个果树呢开了很多花，可是呢，这个花呢到最后都谢落了，不结果，所以它叫做狂花无果，就是开了很多花，可是最后连一个果子都不结，这就是譬喻外道。那智者大师就来譬喻说，像声闻人，这个就是修这个阿罗汉呢。他们修行的时候，他要修种种的苦恨。你看那个大迦叶尊者，他是头头恨第一，修苦恨修十二种苦恨。那他最后呢，证得大阿罗汉的果位，就是他的果位只有一个。所以呢，智者大师就譬喻说，那个叫做多花一果，就是你修行很多苦的法门，但是呢，最后有一个这个果位会一定可以证得的。那像圆觉。他们呢叫做一花一果，他修行一个法门，修行十二因缘法，然后最后证必知佛果，所以那叫一花一果。那菩萨呢他是叫做先花后果，就是说他先开花，以后呢他会结果，因为他行菩萨道，最后呢他证得佛果。
So, for Buddhism,it says that if we cultivate any dharma door, then we will have a result. So in Buddhism, there's a principle, whatever seed you plant, you will reap that fruit. You will reap what you sow. So do not be concerned that whatever you cultivate, there will be no result. There will be no benefit from when we cultivate. For sure, cause and effect is true. And we will reap what we sow. So within the 10 Dharma realms, there's 4 realms, which are the realms of the sages. There's a realm of the Arhat, there's a realm of the Pratyeka Buddha, and the realm of the Bodhisattva. To become an Arhat, one cultivates the 4 Noble Truths. To become a Pratyeka Buddha, one cultivates the 12 conditioned links. To become a Bodhisattva, one practices the 6 Paramitas. In the Avatamsaka Sutra, it explains how the Bodhisattva goes through all the various stages of the Bodhisattva, and much of this is based on the 6 Paramitas. From the Lotus Sutra, It talks about the fruition of Buddhahood. And it basically says all those vehicles before, that of the Arhat, the Pratika Buddha and the Bodhisattva, they're expedients. They're not real vehicles. Rather, it's the Buddha vehicle and the Buddha fruit. And so if we cultivate and we plant the seeds, then we will reap the reward of what we do. And otherwise, what the Buddha would be doing would be lying to us. He would be tricking us, because we would not have a result. But we do not have to worry. For sure, if we cultivate according to the Dharma, there will be a corresponding result. For externalists, however, they cultivate, and their results oftentimes are not perfect, not complete. They oftentimes, and for externalists, they can actually cultivate extremely vigorously. They can have very extreme ascetic practices that are far more difficult than the Buddhist extreme ascetic practices. And so they really cultivate. However, since their cultivation is not ultimate, then they cannot actually have any kind of realization. So Great Master Zidza gave an analogy. He said it's like a tree that bears fruits and flowers. So those cultivating the externalist path are, you could say, like a fruit tree that ends up blossoming many flowers, but there is no fruit. So it's like the ascetic and externalist paths. They cultivate and they have real great spiritual power. So it's quite, you know, marvelous. It looks quite marvelous, but really there is no fruit, nothing that comes from it. Now, in terms of the others, for instance, the sound hearers and the arhats, like Mahakashyapa, he cultivated vigorously the 12 Dutanga practices or 12 ascetic practices, and he became a great arhat. So the analogy that Great Master Zidza gave was that he's like a fruit tree that has many flowers, but only one fruit, and that is arhatship. And for the Pratika Buddha, he said that they are like one flower and one fruit. And so for the Bodhisattva, so the Pratika Buddha has one flower and one fruit. So the Bodhisattva, however, the flower blossoms, and later one realizes the fruit of Buddhahood. So the fruit of Buddhahood comes soon. Then after.
在南圣地的菩萨呢，因为他有智慧了，这个智慧有全智，有实智。全智就是全巧方便，用善巧方便的法门来教化众生，或是摧服这个外道邪见。他也有真实的智慧，这真实的智慧就是一种佛的智慧。那菩萨所学习的就是佛的智慧，因此呢，他能够这个摧服一切外道邪见。那目的就是要让所有的众生住在实地中，这个实就是真实，地就是一种真理，就是一种真实的真理里头，就让众生呢明白真理，依据这个真理来修行，就不会走上这种岔路了，或是走上一种偏邪的道路上，这个永远呢走在菩提道，走在菩提道将来就证菩提果，一定是成佛果的。所以我们要怎么才能够呢对这种所谓真实的这种真理能够来信受奉行呢，那就是要依据经典，依据到佛所说的这种教理，还有依据善知识所教导我们的种种法门来修行，我们就可以住在这个实地中。这个实地呢，其实归根究底就是在讲什么，讲我们的真心，我们的真心就是我们的佛性，就是我们的自性。这个很多不同的名词，像楞严经就讲如来藏性，那在这个华严经呢会讲真如，法华经呢就讲实相或是大圆净智都是属于这种实地，就是真实的义理。那事实上就是说，我们的真心跟佛的心是完全一模一样的，众生的心呢跟佛的心 都是平等一如的，没有慈悲，那表示说佛有这个真心，佛有佛性，众生也有佛性，所以众生有佛性，那将来一样可以像佛呢，都可以成佛，这就是一种真理。那佛呢到这个世间来，他就是知道我们众生都不明白这样的一个真理，因此呢他特别到世界上来教导我们。因此在法华经就讲到说呢，佛以一大事因缘故出现于世，就是佛呢到这个世界来有一个大事，这个大事呢是什么呢？他说要开佛之见，示佛之见，悟佛之见，入佛之见，就是要开佛的之见。佛的之见就是佛的这种佛知佛见，就是佛呢佛的心或是众那个我们的真心。佛呢希望呢把每个众生他的真心打开，让每个众生都知道说你们呢每个人都跟佛一样有这种佛性的，你们呢修行也可以成佛。那么所以呢它叫做开佛之见，示佛之见，示就是指示给我们看，每个人都有这样的同样的这种之见佛性。那悟佛之见，然后根据这个法门来修行，可以悟入悟就开悟了，明白这个真的我们有佛性，我们呢修行这种华严经的种种法门呢，最后一定可以呢像佛一样成佛，所以到最后叫做入佛之见，就是证入到佛的佛知佛见，也表示说佛到这世界上来，就是先让众生明白每个众生有佛性，皆堪作佛，最后呢每个人修行了都可以像佛一样也来成佛。
So here this bodhisattva is on the ground of difficult conquest, and he has two types of wisdom. He has the wisdom of expedient means and also true wisdom. And the expedient means he uses to teach living beings, and the true wisdom of the Buddha he can use to subdue all the deviant views of the externalists. And what he does is it wants to bring all living beings to dwell within absolute truth, true principle, the way things actually are. And he wants living beings to be able to walk on the bodhisattva path and walk on the correct way so that they don't go off on a side path and get lost. So by walking on the bodhi path, then the living beings for sure can realize the Buddha's fruit. They can arrive to Buddhahood. So in the how does one... you could say, understand this true principle. Well, for us, we can really study the sutras and try to understand the sutras and also draw near good and wise advisors to teach us. That's how we can draw near or get closer to this true reality, the way things actually are. In the Buddhism, there's many words for this. There's many signifiers, you could say. It's sometimes called the true mind. Sometimes it's called the Buddha nature. Sometimes it's called the Tathagata Garbha, or the matrix of the Thus Come One in the Sarvangama Sutra. Sometimes it's called true suchness, and sometimes it's called the true mark, which is in the Lotus Sutra, that's what it calls it. So this true mind is also considered the Buddha nature, and it's shared by all Buddhas and shared by all living beings. The living being's true mind is the same as the Buddha's true mind. The Buddha nature in Buddhas is the same as a Buddha nature in living beings. So all living beings can become Buddhas. We have that potential. That's a true principle. So the Buddha comes down to this world because he knows that living beings do not understand this. And he wants to come and teach us this so that we can, and he says this is the true reason. And the Lotus Sutra says the Buddhas come to teach because they want to teach the Buddha's knowledge and then Buddha's understanding and way and knowledge and understanding. And so it said that they say Kai Shi Wu Ru, which in English if you be he opens this understanding and this knowledge, this proper knowledge and understanding, that basically all living beings have this Buddha nature. Then he sure he points out, he demonstrates this, he lets living beings know that. And then so all living beings can then realize this Buddha nature. And then after that, they rule or they enter into the Buddha's views and knowledge. So that's the four steps.
所以每个人有佛性有真心就是实地真实的这种真理，那我们知道了这个真理就必须相信，因为呢，如果我们不相信就不肯修行了。所以在华严经就讲说呢，信为道源功德母，功德母这个信信心还有相信呢，是一种道源修道的一种源头，也是一种功德的母亲。那另外一句在大智度论讲说呢，佛法大海，唯信能唯信能入，就是这个佛法像一个大海一样，那你要怎么才能够到这个大海里头去呢？你要有信心才能够到大海里头去遨游。因此呢，对佛法生信心是非常重要的，包括我们修净土法门都需要有信愿行有信心有愿力有修行念佛，你才可以往生到极乐世界。因此信心呢，不管是在修行佛法上，或是即使在世间法也是很重要的。我们自己对自己有信心，那你在修行的法门里头，比如说你修净土法门，你念佛呢可以往生到西方极乐世界。那就有一个讲法说，你现在念阿弥陀佛死的时候呢，念阿弥陀佛就佛来接引你到西方极乐世界。现在呢，你念佛了，然后释迦牟尼佛又现前来跟你说，我现在有一个这个比念阿弥陀佛更好的法门我现在就教你。但是如果你修净土法门的人，你就死心塌地，你说我只要修这个净土法门就够了，其他呢我不再修了，那因为我信心具足，即使佛现前来教导你另外一个法门，你都愿意呢死心塌地就相信这样佛所讲过的一个法门，这就是表示我们有信心了。所以像这种所谓菩萨在教化众生住在实地中也是一样，我们知道这个道理了，就是说菩萨教导我们要离开这个邪知邪见，那相信我们都有佛性，我们依据华严经来修行都可以成就佛果的。那这个信心如果建立以后呢，我相信将来每个人在修行上，不管碰到任何困难，碰到任何这种阻碍，或是业障现前，都可以呢继续因为凭着信心那继续呢勇猛的精进，最后一定会有成就的。
So that all living beings have the Buddha nature is true principle. But as living beings, oftentimes we don't believe this. We don't know this. So in Buddhism, having this kind of belief, and you can say something that's translated as confidence or faith, maybe use the word confidence, is that they have this confidence in themselves and allows them to cultivate the Buddha Dharma. If they don't have this confidence, well, they don't cultivate. In the Avatamsaka Sutra, it says that this faith or this confidence is the mother of all merit and virtue. It allows one to truly begin one's cultivation. It's also said that the Buddha Dharma is like the great ocean. To be able to enter it, one first needs to have this faith, to have confidence, to be able to then even enter into the great ocean of the Dharma. So we didn't have this really deep and solid faith in the Dharma, in the Buddhism, and as well as ourselves. In the Pure Land tradition, it talks about faith, practice, and vows. There are the three essential components to the Pure Land practice. Now, this also includes yourself. We ought to have the self-confidence that if we cultivate, we can go to the Pure Land. And how do you one understand this kind of faith or this kind of confidence? Is that even if a Pure Land practitioner who has made these vows and is cultivating this Pure Land Dharma Door knows that I cultivate now, then at death, Amitabha Buddha will come and receive me. But in between this time, even if Shakyamuni Buddha were to appear before me and say, I have an even better method for you than this Pure Land method, the Pure Land practitioner would say, thank you very much, but I'll stick to my practice of Amitabha Buddha's Pure Land. that's real solid faith and true belief. And they're sticking to their practice and sticking with it. And by allowing for that, then one's able to really cultivate and be based on this true principle. And by cultivating that, one then will become can become a Buddha. And even when karmic obstructions manifest, one can still maintain one's cultivation and get through it.
讲个故事给大家听好了。在中国春秋战国时代，那个时候有一块很出名的玉叫做和氏璧，很多人都知道，也知道这个故事的。和氏璧呢是像一个国宝，国家的宝贝的。那这个和氏璧呢，它怎么来的呢？原来呢，它出产在这个楚国，楚国在南方。那里有一座山叫金山。这个金山里头呢，有一个人呢，就在那里叫卞和呢，他发现了，有一块石头，因为他是一个专家，他知道这个石头里面呢，有一块这种价值连城举世无双的这种宝玉在里面。因此呢，这个卞和呢，他知道这一块石头太有价值了，不是一般人呢能够买得起，或是能够接受这样一个宝物的，他就想把这块玉献给国王，他就带着这一块石头呢，去见国王。那国王呢，他对这个玉呢，是一个外行，他当然呢不知道，他就找一些玉匠，专门的制玉的玉匠，来鉴定一下这块石头到底是不是真的是一个稀世之宝啊，是真的玉在里头呢？结果呢，这个玉匠来了，大家呢很多人看了这块石头都说。说国王这个是石头啊，这个根本就不是玉。这下呢，这个国王就很生气啊，这个叫做楚厉王很生气，就说哇，你居然胆大包天，敢来骗国王，就叫人呢把这个卞和的左脚给砍断了来惩罚他。那这卞和呢，真的是也是百口莫辩，为什么？因为他除非呢。那个石头呢被琢磨了变成一块玉，但是呢他也没办法，就把这个石头又带回去了。那么后来这个国王死了，另外一个国王又继位了叫楚武王是一个武王。这个武王就位以后呢，这个卞和不死心，他还是很坚持相信这个石头里头有这个玉，因此呢又拿这块石头又要来献给国王。这个国王呢又一样的又找了玉匠再来鉴定一下，结果这个玉匠呢，他们最终的结论就说这只是一块石头，也不是玉所以这下国王也生气了，怎么办呢又把他的右腿给砍断来惩罚他。这下呢他左腿右腿都不见了，那不见了你想想看，人呢为了一块石头那还不死心，他呢觉得自己太委屈了，这个明明的是个宝，但是大家都不认识所以呢以后这个国王又死了，第三个国王又就位了叫文王。这个但是这一次呢，这个卞和呢并没有带这个石头来见国王了，其实呢这时候他没有两条腿，走路也不方便了，不过这时候他就在这个山脚下就怎么样抱着这一块石头痛哭流涕，哭得很伤心，哭了三天三夜，哭到怎么样呢，把眼泪都流干了这个眼睛里头都流血了。所以呢有人发现说为什么他哭得这么伤心呢，就去报告国王。这个国王一听呢就想说是不是叫人去问问他说是不是因为呢你两条腿被砍了，所以呢你现在这么伤心你的腿不见了。这个卞和说我不是伤心我的腿不见，我伤心的是这个石头里头呢明明就是举世无双的宝玉，但是呢世人都不相信，还呢说我是一个骗子我伤心的是大家呢都不相信我是一个很忠心要把这个宝玉献给国王的人。这下子国王呢就觉得事情呢很奇怪了，就真的找这个制玉匠的人去琢磨这块玉，结果琢磨以后呢就发现真的是一块宝玉，这个玉很大而且没有瑕疵，那个玉上呢真的是晶莹剔透，就变成了一块宝，所以就把它命名叫叫做和氏璧因为是卞和发现的。 那从这个故事呢，其实故事本身当然没有特别的意义，不过我就想到了一个道理了，就是说石头里头呢啊藏了玉，叫好像说石中隐玉，那个玉呢隐藏在石头里面。就像我们每个人，我们看起来就是一个人啊，一个身体，那我们众生都认为这个身体就是我啊，啊我们也如果我们不学佛，我们怎么知道说这个我里面有什么佛性啊，我们这个佛性在哪里啊，我们根本不知道，因为我们没有那个智慧。那你想想看呢，如果我们人死了，你把它烧一烧啊，那我们的佛性又跑去哪里啊？是不是佛性就烧完了呢？也不是，这个佛不是这样教我们的，这个佛性是不生不灭的。就是说在我们这个啊，不管我们的身体，即使我们的身体没有了，我们的都有一个佛性，我们 只要相信我们有佛性，那我们依据这个佛性来脚踏实地修行，就可以离苦得乐了，不要在这个世间受六道轮回，我们就可以成就菩萨道，也可以成就佛果，那这个才是真正的。所以我讲这个故事的目的就是说，你看了、啊、如果我们修行真的能够死心踏地相信我跟这个十方诸佛，跟阿弥陀佛、释迦牟尼佛、弥勒佛都一样有这个佛性，我只要啊、根据经典来修行一定可以成佛，你有这个信心，就像那个卞和一样啊，他呢就他不管这个腿不见了，或是人家在砍他的头，他还是会相信说这个石头里头就是有玉啊，因为他是一个专家。
So let me tell a story. This was during the China, the Warring States period, and there was a man, a piece of jade that people probably have heard of, which is a very precious, you can say, a national treasure. And this was called the He Shi Bi, or the say I think it's He Shi Jade. And so it was a very precious piece of jade. So what was the story for this? Well, during the country of Chu, it's just in the south, there was a man named Bian He who found a rock that contained an enormous piece of jade. It was extremely valuable. He found this on a mountain at the time, it was called Gold Mountain. And so he found this precious jade and he thought, well, this is too precious. This is too precious for any ordinary person, any common person. The only person who really can deserve this is the king. So he went to offer this precious jade to the king. Now the king himself was not an expert in jade, and so he went and asked a number of jade experts to come take a look at this rock. Now these jade experts came look at the rock, and they told the king, well, from our analysis, this rock is just a rock. There is no jade here. And so so the king then got very angry and said, are you trying to trick me? Are you trying to make me look like a fool? So he took this man, Bian He, and he cut off his left leg out of punishment. And so Bian He was very sad and you could say went back without his left leg, and he took the rock back. So later this emperor, this king died, and so a new king came, took his place. This was King Chu Wu, who was a King Wu. And so again Bian He thought to himself, this piece of jade is extremely valuable and this rock is extremely valuable. I need to offer it to the king. So he went to this king, King Wu, and said, I would like to offer you this piece of jade. This is extremely precious. Again, this king did not know what it was, so he had some jade experts come and take a look. Again, the verdict was the same. They said it was just a rock. Now, this King Wu also got angry. He said, okay, and he cut off this man Bian He's right leg. And so now he had to go back home sad with neither of his legs. He no longer could walk. So later, this king also passed away. And the third king came to the throne. This was King Wen. Now this time, Bian He didn't go and meet this king. And he at this point couldn't walk anymore. He had no leg. So he was at the bottom of the mountain and he was crying. He was crying very sorrowfully. And for 3 days and three nights, to the point that he was actually crying out blood. Now, these other people nearby saw this, I thought this was very strange and went to report this to the king. Now the king sent a message asking, why are you so sad? Is it because both your legs have been cut off out of punishment? And Bianhe's response was, no, I'm not sad because I have no more legs. Rather, it is because I know in this rock is a piece of jade, but no one believes me. They all think that I am a liar, that I'm trying to cheat the emperor and cheat the king. Rather, I know that in this piece of jade is true, that I'm really a loyal and good person, and I want to offer this to the king. Now, the king thought, oh, this person is very strange. And so he got the jade experts again to take a look at this piece of jade. At that point, they realized, wow, this piece of jade inside was extremely precious. It was an extremely large piece of jade and an extremely pure piece of jade. And so this became this jade called He Shi Bi. I think the He signifies this person's name, which was Bianhe. So you can say this story maybe doesn't have any particular special meaning. However, I think if we want to relate it to some Dharma principle, you could say this jade hidden inside this rock is just like our Buddha nature hidden within us. Us living beings have this physical body, but within it is our Buddha nature. But we don't know that. We have no wisdom. We don't see this Buddha nature. And what happens, say, when we die and our physical body is cremated, and is our Buddha nature now gone? Is it no longer there? That's not the case, because our Buddha nature, you say, does not come nor go, is not born or does not and does not die. It does not arise and does not cease. So if we can cultivate vigorously and really practice, we can realize Buddhahood. And if we really cultivate according to the Buddhist sutras, then we have no fear, because we will be able to for sure be successful in realizing Buddhahood. We have to have confidence that we truly have this Buddha nature that is the same as all the Buddhas of the 10 directions, the same as Amitabha Buddha, as Shakyamuni Buddha, all the Buddhas of the 10 directions. We share in this nature. We have this firm, solid faith or confidence in this.
这个菩萨呢，住在南生地，他行四摄法，叫布施、爱语、力行、同事，如是一切诸手作业，皆不离念佛，不离念法，不离念僧，乃至不离念具足一切种一切自治。这个菩萨呢，他除了修行六波罗蜜以外，同时要行四摄法。四摄法叫布施，布施就是财施、法施，还有无畏施，就是呢帮助众需要帮助的众生，给他们金钱、物质，或是佛法或是他们恐惧害怕，都来行布施。爱语就是讲柔软的语众生欢喜听的这些话语。那力行就是做一些有利于众生的所有的行为，让他们生欢喜心。同事就是跟众生和黄同尘一起来共事，来影响他们以身作则，那这样来教化众生。那举一个例子来讲，比如说你到道场来，到伯克莱圣寺，你这里呢是一个常常来护法的居士的，你对这里的所有的事情都很熟悉。如果有一个新的人来了，那你就开始要行这个四摄法布施，就是说你要请他，比如说他需要一个垫子你就布施一个垫子给他，让他能够打坐或是教他这个佛法怎么打坐的姿势那这个就是一种布施了。那爱语就是他可能来的时候对环境不熟悉，那你就用一种很柔软的话语来跟他谈话，让他呢也不会陌生，也不会害怕，然后就开始会喜欢来这里修行。力行呢，就是教导一些或是做一些事情，让他呢对他有帮助的。比如说他来了，那他不知道洗手间在哪里，你就带他去或是他需要什么东西像一个经本呢或是我们课诵本，你就可以来帮忙他，或是告诉他现在已经在第几页第几行了，那就是做一些对他有利的行为。然后同事就是你也跟他一起在修行，那他知道看你怎么做就跟着你怎么做，这就是一种叫做四摄法。菩萨呢会用这种四种 方法来摄受众生，就是让来影响众生、亲近众生，让众生呢对他产生好感，那菩萨才有办法进一步来教化他们。其实这个同时呢，也是代表菩萨呢在培养自己的德行，因为呢他在付出的同时呢，就是在积功累德。如果自己有这个德行了以后呢，他就可以来影响众生、教化众生。所以呢，菩萨把这一切呢，他所做的事业、善业呢，帮助众生的种种的这种善业，都怎么样？不离念佛、不离念法、不离念僧，就是都是为了三宝、佛法僧三宝。同时呢，他在行事设法的同时呢，也是他的念头里头都是三宝、佛法僧，乃至不离念具足一切种、一切自治，就是甚至呢不没有离开具足一切种。这个种就是佛种啊，每个人都有佛种。这个佛种呢它呢是有一个因缘的，所以法华经会讲佛种从缘起啊，就是有一个佛种，那我们知道了，那以后呢它就会长菩提芽，以后呢就结菩提果。一切自治，这个一切自治是智慧中的智慧，就是说佛的智慧，最高的智慧了，表示说菩萨呢他要求这种最无上的佛果，也就是表示在南生地的菩萨他也希望能够成佛，那这就是他的最终目标。
So this Bodhisattva on the fifth ground, he cultivates giving, kind words, beneficial actions, similar work, and he does all these things. I mean, he does not, you could say, he does all these things when he's constantly mindful of the Buddha, he's constantly mindful of the Dharma, constantly mindful of the Sangha, and he's constantly mindful, you could say, of the seed to Buddhahood, and also of the Buddha's complete highest wisdom, the wisdom of omniscience. So in terms of giving, there's three kinds of giving: of inner outer wealth, of Dharma, of fearlessness. And so that's some way of creating good affinities with living beings. In terms of kind words, one speaks in a way that is very, you could say, very gentle, very calming. It just delights the listener, and that way draws living beings in as well. Also, beneficial actions, you actually help them out. You help make them happy or support them. So that's beneficial action. And working together means that, or similar work means that you're doing something with them, you're working together, and you can embody the Dharma in this case. And by embodying the Dharma, then they can learn from your example. So an example of this maybe would be at Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. People come here and they're Dharma protectors. As a Dharma protector here, you see a new person come to the monastery. So now you can give to them. For instance, you can have a meditation cushion, you can help them put out a meditation cushion for them, and show them, okay, this is how you, so then you're giving them a meditation cushion. Then you can explain to them with kind words, you know, this introduce the monastery, explain to them how to meditate. So you're giving some Dharma, but also teaching them with kindness and kind words. Then you can help them out. So for instance, they might not know where the bathroom is, so you point where the bathroom is, so they can go to the bathroom. Or you help them find their sutra text if we're learning the sutras or reciting from the daily handbook. And from the daily handbook, you can also point out what page we're on. So we're doing actions that help the person. And then working together as you're cultivating together so that they're able to watch you and they learn from your example. So all of these four, say these four practices are the gathering in dharmas of the Bodhisattva. They gather living beings in. And there are ways to create good affinities with living beings so that one can then support and teach them. And also, not just does it create good affinities, it also cultivates one's virtuous, this kind of virtue. One cultivates one's virtue. So this Bodhisattva cultivates all these things, but is not separate, is not apart from the three jewels. And those are the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. So everything he does, he's mindful of the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. And so he cultivates, and also he cultivates, and it's actually missing from the translation, but he also cultivates and does not forget the Buddha seed, which is the seed of enlightenment. So you have this seed of Buddhahood, and when it fruitions, it becomes a Buddha. You're a Buddha. So that's, they're not apart from this Buddha's seed. And as well, they're not apart from, translated here as the wisdom of the knowledge of all modes. But essentially, this is the highest wisdom. This is the Buddha's wisdom. This is, you can often translate it as omniscience.
有一句话说, 未成佛道先结人缘, 所以跟人结善缘是很重要的, 所以我们可以看到, 菩萨在修行过程中, 他到处来帮助众生, 来跟众生结善缘, 啊, 就是自利, 利他, 自觉, 觉他, 那这个结善缘呢, 在我们日常生活中, 时时刻刻, 其实都可以来做的, 那我们要是, 除了跟众生结善缘之外, 其实不只是众生的, 你也要怎么样, 跟道场结善缘, 你也要跟经典结善缘, 为什么这个道场可以摄受你? 我举一个例子, 你跟伯克莱有缘, 那哪一天你在外面迷了, 伯克莱圣士, 啊, 他会摄受你到这个庙里来的, 那像比如说, 很多人跟万佛圣城有缘, 他本来也不知道万佛圣城的, 可是万佛圣城会摄受他, 因为他过去生中, 可能呢, 啊, 供养过万佛圣城, 可能在万佛圣城做过义工, 所以万佛圣城跟他有缘, 会再把他摄受回去的, 那你, 今天来听华严经, 表示呢, 你跟华严经是有缘的, 因为过去生中就结了这个缘, 那这一生当中, 虽然你在, 是一个在家人, 啊, 那同时有工作, 有家庭, 或怎么样, 但是呢, 你以前不明白佛法, 可是慢慢的, 华严经也会把你摄受回来, 啊, 就是不是说只有人, 啊, 不是只有这个佛啊, 菩萨, 或是像上人, 善知识, 可以摄受众生, 经典也可以摄受众生, 道场也可以摄受众生, 甚至, 啊, 这个有情无情, 都可以摄受众生, 这个无情呢, 就像道场嘛, 道场是一个无情啊, 因为它没有这种, 没有生命, 啊, 没有气血, 所以叫无情, 那无情呢, 也可以摄受众生, 所以你想想看, 我们如果跟人呢, 结善缘, 啊, 或是跟, 有情无情众生结善缘, 其实都是非常重要, 等于说, 我们, 如果不能脱离六道轮回, 那在, 或是你下一生还在六道, 可是呢, 你遇不着佛法的时候, 可是过去生中, 你跟有情无情的众生, 跟道场, 跟经典, 跟所有的, 啊, 这些善知识, 或是修行人结了缘, 那这些人都可以再摄受你回来, 然后继续再修行的。
So there's a saying in Buddhism that if one wants to, or one, before one realizes the fruition of Buddhahood, one first needs to create good affinities with living beings. It's because through teaching and transforming living beings, one realizes Buddhahood. It comes from awakening oneself and also awakening others. Not just people can gather living beings in, but the monastery can gather people in. The sutra can gather people in. How can you explain this? Let's say, for instance, the Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. In the past, you've created affinities with Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. And one time, you kind of get lost. You don't know what you're doing. But the Berkeley Buddhist Monastery can gather you back in. Or, for instance, the City of 10,000 Buddhas. Those who come to the City of 10,000 Buddhas, probably in their past lives, have created affinities with the City of 10,000 Buddhas. Perhaps they made an offering to a CDTB. Or they volunteered at CDTB. So now in this life, when they have the opportunity, they draw near the City of 10,000 Buddhas. Another example would be the Avatamsaka Sutra. Here we're listening to the Avatamsaka Sutra tonight, which shows that we all have some affinities with this sutra. As laity, I'm sure people are busy with work and families, etc. But still, one has the affinity with the Avatamsaka Sutra to be brought into the Dharma. Because if you didn't have affinity at all, you wouldn't have been drawn in. So it's not just the Venerable Master or the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, but even monasteries, sutras, sentient beings, insentient beings can all gather us in. An insentient object, like the monastery, is like an insentient object, but it still gathers us in. So even the monastery and the sutras can gather us in. How much less can living the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas? So you can see that basically It's very important to create good affinities with living beings, and also create good affinities with the monastery and the sutras.
最后我讲一个我看到的新闻，这是一个多月前我看了一个新闻，但是我觉得可能我没有什么答案，但是我想给大家想一想，根据我前面讲的说，跟这些有情无情的众生结缘啊。那这个新闻是这样讲，是说在过年的时候啊，在台湾这个花莲有一个男人呢，男人呢，他想多赚一点钱，他就利用这个晚上的时间到海边去抓鱼苗啊，那是在台湾有一种鱼苗叫鳗鱼啊，鳗鱼苗是很贵的，因为有人就把它就需要这个鱼苗去养大它，然后可以卖很多钱，那所以在台湾有这样的行业。那我讲这个只是一个故事，所以你不要误解啊，我只是要表达一个故事。那他为了多赚一点钱，也其实是为了他的孩子，因为他有一个小孩子呢快要出生了，他希望能够让这个孩子过好一点的生活，希望所以他去晚上呢在海边抓鱼苗，其实是很危险的，因为第一个他不会游泳，第二个在晚要从晚上一直工作到将近天亮，那他就这样冒着危险在那边工作。那有一天呢到早上了他准备回家了，四点钟了，等到他要上岸了，这个时候呢来了两个浪就把他卷走了，卷到海里头去。那他不会游泳啊，卷到浪里这个海里头怎么办呢？那我们想当然是必死嘛。可是呢就这么巧，他呢就在那边在浮浮沉沉啊，就是不知道怎么办的时候了，那时候也不可能有人救他嘛，那海边不会有人的。结果呢就飘来一块棺材板你知道那死人的棺材板那个就是已经就飘到海上的。那他看到这棺材板真的是就像那个救命丹一样，就抱住那个棺材板，就抱着他不能放了，因为放就死了。结果怎么抱了，那一直就抱了，一直飘一直飘。那他这个时候呢因为在海上飘嘛，那个海水还是 往南边流啊。他说这个时候他因为在海上啊在漂流，他什么都想，他一直想很多事情，所有的事情都想过了。他说呢他唯一不想的，他只有一个事情他不想，你们想想看他什么事情不想，他什么事情都想过了，只有一个事情他不想，对，他不想死。你看呢没有人会想死的，你看他到海上的时候他唯一不想就是不想死。那结果呢哇，他这种求生意志啊，经过了六十个小时他最后被救了，然后呢他真的没有死。这个是很特别的一个故事。可是我看这个新闻，我的感想是说，我的想法就是说，那这个男人跟这个棺材板有什么关系啊？一定有关系的，不会怎么他这么危险的时候有一个棺材板就飘过来，如果他没有跟这一块木头结一个善缘，或是以前曾经躺在棺材里头那个死人结一点善缘的话，怎么会这么巧就跑着棺材板就飘这个飘到他的身边来。如果你想想看，你在海上不会游泳，那个棺材板离个二十尺三十尺还是抓不到嘛，怎么就在身边啊？所以他就靠这一块板子活了过来。然后我就从这个故事呢，我就想到这个男人呢一定以前呢，我是猜想啊，因为我也不知道，我就想说以前这一棵树啊是一棵大树，它被做成一棵可以做棺材板，一定是很大的树。或许呢这个男人呢以前呢跟这棵树结过善缘啊，他种过它，或是帮他浇过水啊，或是他倒的时候呢帮他扶正了，所以呢这棵你看到这个无情呢可能跟他有缘啊。或是呢我也想说或许这个在这个比如说躺在棺材里头的人呢也许呢跟这个男人过去生中也有一些善缘所以呢你看其实虽然那个他那个棺材已经没有用了，可能从山上飘到海里面，可是棺材板还是发挥一些作用。我讲这个呢不是有任何意味，我只是把这个问题呢让大家去回去想一想，说为什么 我们有些人就特别幸运啊，他就可以碰到这个棺材板，万一他碰不到，当然你就知道结果，那不是每个人都可以这么幸运的。所以我的意思是，其实是鼓励我们在日常生活中，我们能够跟任何人或是任何众生，不管有情无情结善缘，那我们就要把握机会，也许哪一天呢，我们都可以用得上。
So finally, in conclusion, maybe I can tell a news story. So I read this news story about a month before, and I can say there's not really any, it's the kind of questions that get brought up, and I don't know if there's any real solution for it. But I wanted just to share it with everybody, so to see what people think. This story happened around the New Year at this time. There was a layman, or not layman, he's just a man, who lived in the Hualien area in Taiwan. And so to make more money, he went to eel. So he went to collect eel. He tried to catch eel because I guess eel are very expensive. People raise it as well. And the reason he went to try to catch the eel is because he also was going to have a newborn child. So he thought maybe having a little bit more money, then he could his child could have a more comfortable life. And so he worked all day, and then in the evenings and night he would go to the ocean and try to catch these eels. It was very dangerous because he didn't really know how to swim, and he was tired from an entire day of work. So one time when he was returning about early in the morning, maybe 4 a.m., two big waves came and caught him and pulled him back into the ocean. So he started drifting out into the ocean, and he didn't really know how to swim. So for sure, in this kind of scenario, he probably would die for sure. But lo and behold, what happened? Well, a plank of wood that was used to make coffins came by next to him, and he basically grabbed onto this plank of wood. Before nothing was around, he was, just confused and lost and very in dire straits. So now he grabbed this plank of wood and held onto it for dear life. And he drifted all over the place for a long time. He thought a lot. He was, was worried and thinking about all sorts of things. But what didn't he think about? What didn't he want to do? So we asked out, and somebody said he didn't want to die. That's right. He was really adamant and had a real strong will to live. So although he was floating around for 60 hours on the ocean, he was later rescued, and he did not die. So I heard the story, and I thought it was quite an amazing story. If you think about it, it's quite amazing. This person would be in the ocean, and a plank of wood from a coffin would just come by, and he'd be able to catch it and save himself. So I thought, well, this is kind of interesting. How did this happen? Why would this plank of wood come by him and when he was in the ocean? So I don't have any real solution or answer to this question, but maybe just a way to think about it. I was just kind of guessing myself to think about it. It was maybe he's created some affinity with this wood, this piece of wood from a coffin. Maybe he has some affinity with this person who died, that he created some good affinity so that even though this plank of wood no longer is being used in the coffin, it came down from the mountains and happened to come right by him. Because what's the chances of that piece of wood just coming right by him when he was in the middle of the ocean, that a piece of wood would come by that he could grab onto? Or maybe he had some affinity with this tree. Maybe this tree, at one point he planted this tree, or maybe he watered this tree. Maybe when the tree was falling down, he helped it get back upright again. So maybe he created some good affinity with this tree. And so now this piece of wood came by and he could have an affinity with it. So maybe he had affinity with the dead person, or maybe an affinity with the tree. So who knows? Because if you look at this world, why are some people fortunate? Why people are not? What's the chances that he would have had this piece of wood come by him? So I don't know the answer to this solution. I just ask everybody else, you can think about it. Why would this happen to him? But maybe you could take this as an encouragement for all of us to create good affinities with all living beings, whether if they're sentient or even insentient beings, insentient objects. We create good relationships with all beings.
See. 很不一样的。
那个问题是，结缘跟攀缘有什么地方不一样？
最简单的定义是，结缘是无所求，攀缘是有所求。
So the question asked was, what's the difference between, we call it climbing on conditions, or maybe manipulation is another way to think about it, or calculating for some personal benefit, and tying up good affinities. And so the answer was, the simplest response would be, when you're climbing on conditions or manipulating, you're seeking after something. When you're creating good affinities, you have no seeking in your mind at all. You're not seeking after something.
你看万佛生成冻死不攀缘啊，就是没有衣服穿了冻死了也不要去攀缘，说哎我快冻死了好可怜啊，不需要。就是你只要上人就讲，你只要有修行，人家就来供养你啊，就是真心修，这个真正修行的人呢就有人会供养的，所以呢就这就是不攀缘。我可以讲再讲一个故事好了，这也是攀缘的故事。说有两个师兄弟，那他们在行脚到一个地方去，有一天呢他们住到一个庙里面去，一个破庙。那他们走了很久啊，到这个庙里头呢，晚上睡觉，其实呢肚子也饿了，可是里面没有东西吃，因为没有人住的庙。这个时候呢这个师兄呢肚子也饿啊，但是呢他晚上呢就盘起腿来打坐了。然后呢这个他的师弟呢就在打妄想啊，说哎呀我们肚子饿了啊，那是不是会有人来供养啊，怎么样怎么样，他心里就打这个妄想。后来你知道这个山上啊都有山神的，这个山神知道了哦，他这个山神就去给这个山下一户人家去托梦，说现在有两个法师啊在山上这个庙里呢没饭吃啊，快饿死了，你们要赶快送食物去供养。结果呢这个山下有一户人家知道了，哎，怎么做了这么奇怪的梦啊？就煮了面啊，两碗面就送到山上这个破庙里头，果然看到两个法师。然后呢，这个师兄一看呢，他就说就骂这个师弟说：“你一定是打妄想，你呢一定打妄想，所以现在有人来供养了，以后呢我呢不要做你师兄了。”这就是攀缘嘛，就是说你看呢、啊、他。一个真正修行的人，他是说我没有人供养，那我饿就饿啊。可是那个结缘不一样，你看在万佛圣城啊，我们放了很多结缘的书在那个祖师殿，那结缘的书呢就放在那边，谁需要谁有需要，或是我觉得这个人来了他有需要就介绍他，那你去介绍给他这些佛书的时候不是一种攀缘啊，是就是要帮助他结缘，因为无所求，那个发心是一种利他的，并不是要利己。如果我们这种发心是利己，那就变成攀缘了，不是为了自己呢为了对方，那就是一种结缘。
So we have the saying in the City of Thousand Buddhas, we have it part of our motto. We say freezing death we do not scheme, starving to death we do not beg, dying apart we ask for nothing.So even if we freeze to death, we don't have any clothing to wear. We don't go well and say, oh, look at me, I don't have nothing to wear. Aren't I so pitiful? Maybe you could give me something to wear. You don't do that. You true cultivators, they don't have that kind of mind. They don't go seeking outside. The Master Hua said, if you just are true in your cultivation, people make offerings accordingly. You don't need to go out and scheme around and try to manipulate situations. And so maybe I can tell a story regarding this.There's a story where two cultivators, their fellow Dharma brothers, two monks, went to in the mountains and found an old temple. Now in this old temple, you know, no one was around, so they both stayed in it to cultivate and meditate. So as these two cultivators were meditating, they had no food because there's no one around. No one offered any food. So both went hungry. Now one of the monks had a false thought, saying, oh, well, there's no food to eat. I thought, wouldn't it be nice if somebody made an offering to us? Now, the mountain spirit, because there's various mountains, they all have these spiritual energies that surround them, saw these two monks and saw that when the monks had a thought of having some food, And so he basically had a dream, gave a dream to an old couple that lived at the bottom of the mountain. And both of them, the couple, husband and wife, both had the same dream, saying that there's these two Dharma masters up on the mountain, they're going hungry. You should cook some noodles and make an offering to them. So these two, this old couple woke up and thought it was strange that they both had the same dream. So they basically brought some offerings up to this temple and found these two monks there. Now, the other monk who didn't have the false thought looked at the other monk and said, you must have had a false thought to have some offerings. Otherwise, how would these people know we were here and make an offering? I'm no longer going to have anything to do with you since you don't have any, you know, you don't have that kind of true heart to cultivate. So you can see in terms of true cultivation, you don't go and have these kind of self-benefiting thoughts. You don't go and climb on conditions. So rather, if you are talking about just tying up good affinities, let's say, for instance, at the 6,000 Buddhas, we have books for their complementary books. So whoever needs it, they're welcome to have them. There's no strings attached. And if somebody comes, you can introduce them to the books, and you're just helping them to tie up some affinities with the Dharma. You're not trying to seek any kind of benefit from them, or not trying to seek any benefit for yourself. So the most basic is that when you're having good affinities with other people, you're in your heart trying to benefit them. But when you're climbing on conditions, you're just trying to benefit yourself.
还有问题吗?
Any more questions? Okay. So we do the transference. It should be in the back of your Dharma request sheet. So as you can see, it says dedication of merit. So whatever you wish to transfer to, please make a wish. May every living being, our minds as one and radiant with light, share the fruits of peace with hearts of goodness, luminous and bright. If people hear and see how hands and hearts can find in giving unity, may their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward. May all who sorrow leave their grief and pain. May this boundless light break the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise. Okay, we can all stand and bow to the Buddhas.